You're listening to WPRS on the Z Talk Radio Network.
The next stop is the Warren Exchange Paranormal Radio Show on the Z Talk Radio Network.
The views expressed and opinions given by the individual hosts and their guests do not necessarily reflect those of Z Talk Radio, its affiliates, or sponsors.
Are you sitting comfortably? Then we'll begin.
You are at the Warren Exchange. I'm your host, Al Warren. And joining us tonight, we have the highly acclaimed medium Reverend Stephen Hermann joining us from New Zealand. Now, Stephen is a featured personality on television and radio worldwide. Not only is he a teacher with the International Spiritualist Federation, he has also written a book called Mediumship Mastery, The Mechanics of Receiving Spirit Communications, The Ultimate Guide. Now we're going to talk to him about his book and about being a medium right after these words.
My name is Tyler Oakley. I know y'all got crazy busy days. Honestly, the only way I can ever get through a crazy day is with some coffee. Thankfully, Starbucks has these brand new mini frappuccinos. Can we talk about how cute these are? That are the perfect size. Whether you are just starting your crazy day or you're halfway through and you need that pick-me-up, they are ideal. Actually, adorable. I know we have all been there where you're trying to decide between two flavors, and honestly, how can you pick between perfection and perfection? Well, now you can get two without feeling guilty. I know, you're welcome in advance.
I'm really psyched Subway's bringing the flavor with this new guacamole for a couple of reasons. First, people really love our guacamole. Rich and creamy, made from Haas avocados and just a hint of jalapeno to keep it interesting. The other reason is, it's just really fun to say. Guacamole.
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 See?
Come in and try our new guacamole on sandwiches like the Chipotle Chicken Melt and discover how it turns up the flavor on all your favorite sandwiches.
Subway. Eat fresh.
You can listen to us anytime, anywhere now. Download our free app now for the iPhone and iPad. Look for the Warren Exchange or House of Mystery app at the Apple App Store today.
Heaven and in Jesus and the saints and all the pride.
And we're back. And joining us is Steve Hermann, and all the way from tomorrow, today, in New Zealand. Thank you for joining us.
Yeah, I'm really happy to be here.
Ah, now let's start out with a little bit of your history. So give some of your story to people so they know kind of who you are.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm based in New Zealand, but I'm actually from the States. So I grew up in Massachusetts, Western Massachusetts, in this town called Amherst. And I work full-time as a medium, and a lot of what I focus on is probably more of the teaching aspect of it, you know, mediumistic development. So I run programs all over the U.S. as well as internationally.
And what got you into that? Like, so you're teaching mainly, but you obviously are a medium. When did that?
Yeah, I'm a medium. I'm not large and I'm not petite or small.
Well, it's kind of a good thing.
I'm kind of out, you know, medium build, you know?
A medium. So you're a medium.
Because I'm a medium.
Oh, exactly. And when did this start for you? Like, when
the first time, I mean, the big thing, see, with mediumship is that it's totally natural. And I think what happens is sometimes there's a tendency for people to put mediums on a pedestal.
Right.
And psychologically, a lot of mediums like to be on a pedestal. So, you know, they have these special gifts and super extraordinary powers, but really, it's just like an artistic or musical type of talent or ability. So everybody has this. I mean, my first experience was when I was around 2 years old. My mom's father, who would have passed 20-something years before I was born, communicated with me. So I had a lot of mediumistic or psychic experiences growing up as a child, which I think is typical with quite a few mediums. On the other hand, I think that everyone has this ability. You know, that's just because someone has those kind of experiences doesn't make them special. Like they have some type of power, you know, that other people don't have.
Right. So you don't necessarily look at it as a gift per se. It's just part of who you are.
Yeah, well, the gift is what comes through. I mean, I know this one medium, he's deceased now, but he used to live in the Phoenix, Arizona area. Whenever he heard the word channel, he always thought of sewage drains. Yeah. That's what he told me. So anyway, I mean, you could have really high-level information and blessings come through, you know, with mediumship, or you could probably have the exact opposite. So, but, you know, the blessing is what comes through from the higher power, you know, that's able to be imparted to people and really help people, heal them, and bring enlightenment or higher awareness to them. But it's really something that's like an artistic skill. So you could have someone, they can only draw stick figures. If they went to a class, you know, the structured educational environment with maybe a qualified teacher, a mentor, and they put the patience, the time in, over a period of time, they would definitely improve past just drawing stick figures. Because so much of it, what is it? It's like hand-eye coordination. So mediumship, everybody has different gifts or different abilities. And those could be cultivated in the right type of atmosphere and, you know, with the right energy putting into those things.
Right. Now, are you thinking then that this is something that we should all do if we all have sort of some sort of level of it?
I think that it's, I mean, not everyone has necessarily the propensity to want to do that. You know, I think not everyone's going to want to play a musical instrument, but I think certainly if someone was to be exposed to different types of music or musical instruments, that's something which is definitely going to be, it's going to be positive. The other thing is, I mean, really, if we go inside ourselves, you know, we learn how to meditate, we learn how to quiet our minds, we all have our own connections with the spirit world. You know, we have spirit guardians. We have people connected to us. I mean, you could have someone, they really don't know their family real well. Maybe all their deceased family people have passed over, but there's still people who are going to be around them from spirit, even if they're not necessarily knowledgeable about the identities of the people. And certainly on a soul or spiritual level, we have guardians or people, personalities who are connected to us. So meditating or, you know, quieting your mind, going inside, that's really, we start to open up that way. We get in touch with our own intuition, which is really beautiful.
And is that sort of the area that you teach in then? So someone that's looking to learn how to quiet the mind, as you say, or meditate and get in in touch.
That's like probably one of the first steps when someone starts to get into this. I mean, I work with people at all levels of development, you know, from someone who might be just totally novice, maybe never has been exposed to it before. You know, you might have someone that their mind is completely analytically oriented. Maybe they work as an engineer. You know, their whole focus and way of thinking is different. You know, you have other people who've been open to it their whole life. They just don't know how to use it. And then I also work with people who are intermediate, or people who are also more advanced or very experienced, you know, and already maybe even professionally working as mediums. I have whole training programs, my mediumship mastery program, you know, just focusing on that, which is more residential or more focused training that's intensive.
So have you been involved in actual, as they call it, investigations, like going out to people's homes or businesses and trying to resolve issues or find out what activity they've got going on?
You know, in my years being involved in this, there have been a few times where I've gone to someone's house for something like that, but I would say my focus is a bit different than that. That's more of an astral plane type of level, you know, which is a bit denser type of energy. Nothing wrong with that, but and probably more on a psychic type of level, if that makes sense.
Yeah, yeah, no, it does. And, you know, I'm just curious, because so many mediums out there do, or ones I've talked to are involved in investigations or some sort of groups or... You know, teams.
Yeah. Well, what I'm probably more involved in is really the healing. You know, I do a lot of work with that. You know, spirit operations, hands-on, spiritual healing, that type of thing, and then also mental mediumship. You know, I'm able to see, hear, and sense spirit. So, bringing through people's guides or deceased personalities who may be family or otherwise who are connected to the person, and then also channeling through, you know, higher teachings, that type of thing.
Right. Now, so, keep going.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. But that's a bit different than someone. You know, you could go into, let's just say you have someone's house, and you know they're feeling all this energy there. Maybe some really creepy energy, or maybe you know they could have a spirit person there that's doing different things. That type of work isn't really my focus at all. There are some people who probably work more on that level.
Oh yeah, I've come across them a lot. Is there any out there that really sort of influence you that are going right now, like popular mediums or you know, groups that are investigating?
God, I'm not so sure. I'm really not that familiar with, because that's not really my field or my focus, you know, the investigation type aspect. But in terms of mediumship, I mean, gosh, in the last 20 years or so, it's really become, through the media, you know, electronic media, television, as well as print media, it's become so popular. You know, there's quite a few mediums, you know, having their own TV shows, that type of thing, and a lot of books that have been published that are quite popular, which I think it's wonderful, because these types of people, they might never go to a spiritualist church, and you know, and I'm also spiritualist, ordained spiritualist minister, you know, certified through the National Spiritualist Association of Churches, and a lot of the work that I do is probably more within the context of a spiritualist church or center format. But with the mediumship that's being done on a wider scale, I mean, you can reach people in their own living rooms on TV. I've done a fair amount of television work myself, which is doing what we're doing right now on the radio. It's wonderful. People can be sitting in their living room, and you can talk to them and expose them to this.
Yeah. I mean, the communication has just gotten incredible.
It's amazing. Yeah, what you can do with the internet, everything, in terms of learning and education.
Yeah. And connecting with people all over the world is so much easier than the old days of traveling all the time. But that's a different story.
It's instantaneous. Well, you know, how do the spirit people communicate with us? Their media, it's mind, it's telepathy, right? Telepathic communication, just like those 1950s B movies.
Yeah.
The aliens. So it's one of those things where it's instantaneous. You know, we talk about the speed of sound. We talk about the speed of light. You know, so we might see some star, you know, up in the sky at night. But that's what we're actually seeing is light. It could be how many millions of years old, you know? And then we're actually seeing it long after the fact that it emitted. So, but with the speed of thought, they can instantaneously, you know, put the idea into your head. And that's why people self-development in terms of learning how to meditate, learning how to get themselves out of the way, you know, the logical or analytical mind, getting that out of the way and actually listening and being able to recognize what's their own imagination and what's actually coming through from another source.
Right. It's really tough to separate the here and now, the life, because, you know, your work and family and
all of those things, yeah, you know, yeah. It's people tend to have so much anxiety, you know, they're worrying about different things or maybe, you know, they do work as an engineer and they're very anally retentive, you know, and rigid, yeah. They're thinking and, you know, you have to be in that job because you have to control everything and make sure it functions the right way. And then, you know, you try to sit down and listen to yourself and something, if something is placed into your head, which intuitively, you know, maybe is coming in from a higher source, what do? You pick it apart. You start analyzing it. And what do you instantaneously block anything else from coming in? So that's a real challenge that people have, especially in this society.
Oh, yeah.
It's not like some indigenous cultures where it's really encouraged.
Yeah, quite different, isn't it? So how did it go for you? But I mean, it started when you were very young. So were you in a setting of a family that had a strong religious center or perhaps not? But how did it affect you being so young?
When I was little, I mean, gosh, I was very open to it. I'm also really very creative or very artistically oriented anyway. So my family wasn't really particularly religious in any approach, which is probably good in some ways just because there wasn't some type of rigid, you know, narrow box, you know, that I would have been expected to confine. But in terms of my own development, I mean, I was exposed to a lot of when I was little. I grew up in Amherst, Massachusetts, which is in the western part of Massachusetts, and very 1960s, 1970s hippie type of culture, which was good because a lot of those types of people were really into alternative healing and alternative meditative types of approaches, things of this sort, spirituality. So I was exposed to a lot of different things like that when I was little, just growing up. You know, my parents weren't really into all that stuff, but...
But it was there for you. It was there.
Yeah, I learned how to meditate when I was little, you know, sat in a meditation class, things like that. And that was great. You know, I really learned how to kind of tune in and get in touch with things. Then I got into a lot of traditional martial arts, you know, Japanese karate, Shotokan, which is a type of Japanese karate. And that's also meditative. You know, you use the intuitive part of your mind if you get into any traditional martial arts. And, you know, I was exposed to different approaches to massage and things of this sort. So
wow. So it was really available. So when you came along with it, and then how did you end up in New Zealand?
Oh, well, I was on tour here, you know, doing mediumship. This is back in 99, and then I came back in 2001. I ended up marrying someone from here. I'm not with them, but I have four kids. So because I have four kids, you know, I want to be with my kids. So that's why I'm here.
Wow.
But originally I came here in 99, I was on tour, you know, I was on TV here, radio and all that, going all over, you know, working, doing programs. And anyway, I do that all over the place, literally. It's pretty crazy.
Oh, wow.
But the thing with New Zealand is the other side of the universe. So I end up having to travel quite a bit, you know, distances in terms of doing my work.
So you've obviously adjusted to life there because you stayed there for, you know, 20 years.
Yeah, but I'm probably out of the country a good 4 months of the year, at least, or more in some cases, you know, going other places, you know, working. I do stuff in Europe and then the States and Australia, Philippines. I do a lot of teaching there. Spiritualism is quite big in the Philippines, you know, a lot of mediumship and healing. So I do a lot of training there, work with a lot of groups there in terms of training programs that I run.
And how does that sit then when you're touring a lot of these countries, there's different, again, when we go to religion, there's different factors. How do are they all pretty open to this, or is there certain areas and countries that, and maybe religions that aren't so open to mediumship?
Well, I guess, you know, I'm a spiritualist, and, you know, spiritualism is a religion. It started in upstate New York. It went to England. Started in New York in 1848, and then it went to England in 1851, went to continental Europe. And actually, the teachings are worldwide. In Brazil, it's known as spiritism. There's tens of millions of people involved in it. In the Philippines, there's about 2,000 spiritualist centers. Now, that's still a minority in terms of religion, like Roman Catholicism is the biggest in the Philippines. But in terms of, there certainly are a lot of denominations of Christianity, even though both the Old and the New Testament is pretty much from beginning to end psychic phenomena. You know, Jesus was a medium, Moses was a medium, all the different prophets, they're mediums. You know, there's all these different examples of psychic phenomena and mediumistic phenomena. It's not really understood. Plus, people watch all these scary movies.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of just misunderstanding about it.
Yeah.
I mean, for example, as a medium, I don't go around. I mean, you're talking about, let's say, going into houses and trying to find, you know, helping out with those types of situations. I don't really do that type of work. But a lot of people, if they thought about mediumship, they probably would think about something like that because that's what you see in the movies. And that's what's portrayed. Or they might think that I'm a fortune teller.
Right.
You know, and it's just different. I mean, you have to use your intuitive or psychic ability with mental mediumship, but it's really very, very, very different, the orientation, and it's maybe it's not on a superficial type of level. It's deeper. Yeah. Nothing wrong with fortune telling. You know, it's what it is, but it's not what I do.
Right. Right. Well, do you think it gives a bad name? Not so much even fortune-telling, but do you think Hollywood and movies and things like that kind of give it a not-as-legitimate name?
Well, I think that the movies that are very, very, very scary, you know, when you have someone, the medium, you know, their head turns around, the green slime comes out, and then they start levitating, things like that,
yeah.
Those types of depictions just aren't the way it is. It's something which is totally, perfectly natural. Now, obviously, if you're going to do a TV show, you want to make it really sensationalistic, that type of thing. But that really gives the wrong impression and just reinforces stereotypes that aren't really true with the way it is. Now, on the other hand, there's definitely movies or television productions that have done reasonable or pretty good portrayals of this type of thing too, which I think is excellent, because what ends up happening is, you know, exposes people and educates people that might otherwise just not know.
Do you what do you suggest? Like, what have you found as to be a favorite movie or story that you've seen?
I remember the movie, I guess it was Ghost. I think that came out, what, like 1990 or 89, around that time. I remember seeing that, and I thought that was really nice. I mean, it had a supernatural, you know, theme to it and everything. I mean, there's a real big difference between some positive, which I thought the depictions in it as a whole were kind of positive, even though it was obviously Hollywood, compared to, I mean, other examples I've seen. I'm not even sure the names, but just, you know, the typical, you know, someone, they start opening up, they're opening up the demonic forces. And
right, like the whole Exorcist thing, right?
It's all that stuff, you know? I mean, it's just ridiculous.
Yeah.
It's just not the way it works.
Yeah. Well, have you, and so in your experience, have you come across, as they say, demons not necessarily bad spirits, but just something really horrific.
The spirit world, there's all different levels. Okay, so let's say someone's going to go to a medium like myself for a session. It's all been orchestrated. It's all totally orchestrated and regulated and controlled by higher personalities in the spirit world. So let's just say you made an appointment with me and you're going to come to me for a session. Now, your grandmother in the spirit world, there might be a really good reason why she wants to communicate with you.
Right.
And so what's she going to do in the meantime, you know, the 2 weeks prior to the session? She's going to have to actually learn the process. She's going to receive training in the spirit world from people who are specialists, who actually understand the mechanics of the process, who actually will work, you know, with in conjunction with my helpers. She'll come through, but the helpers who work with me, who are specialists with this, she actually has to train to be able to do it or even rehearse it. So it's something which is all planned out, and sometimes the session might be more for your grandmother than it is for you.
Right.
Does that make sense? It's you can't really call the spirit people up, but the ones who are going to come through, just because they're in the spirit world, does not mean they're necessarily that evolved. They may be or may not be. But someone who's not evolved if they are going to come through, there's a reason for it, and it usually has to do with their healing or helping them to go up to a higher level.
Okay, so it might not necessarily be to direct it toward you itself, but they might.
Yeah, well, I mean, for example, I remember one time I had one of my I was running some training program, and you know, it ended, and I was doing some private sessions for some of the participants and students who had been there for the weekend, and one of my students from another state had a session, and I believe it was like the anniversary of someone really close, maybe her dad or someone really close to her who was in spirit, you know, who had passed over that weekend. It was a big deal, right? So she had a session with me. Now, the main communicator, I mean, I think the person who she wanted to hear from didn't come through at all. The person who came through the strongest was someone who she recognized, and this was an individual. He'd lived in the neighborhood when she was a child, and he basically had sexually abused a lot of children in the neighborhood. And this was something that, you know, he was obviously had to take responsibility for, and was having to redeem himself and actually work on things as he was in spirit. Now, who set that all up? You know, the higher personalities, there would have been a reason why he was coming through. Do you understand? Relating to her as well as in terms of his own growth. And this guy definitely wouldn't have been someone on a high level. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
So you get all different types of people. I mean, you might have someone who's a very close, you know, loved one. You can have someone who's a casual acquaintance. I remember I had one lady came to one of my group sessions in San Diego a number of years ago. And anyway, the next day she had her husband come for an hour session. And one of the communicators was a 17-year-old boy for the husband who had committed suicide. And I was describing the guy to a T. I mean, and the husband just was not recognizing who I was talking about. And you know, I'm going on, and I wanted to do like the Star Trek handshake. I was talking all this stuff about Star Trek and going on and on about it. So I was trying to go back to the spirit world, you know, asking this guy, you know, to give me more information, just so the recipient could place it. And anyway, he showed himself wearing a yarmulke, you know. So I said, well, he's Jewish. Now, when I said he was Jewish, instantly it all fell into place. Now, the husband, who probably would have been about 40-ish, when he was 17, he and his father had given this guy a ride to a Star Trek convention. He'd gone with them that weekend. He didn't even really remember the guy's name. You understand?
Yeah, yeah.
So it's not necessarily people, you know, the five people who we'd expect to hear from.
Yeah.
So they'll use whatever means possible to come through. But anyone who's coming through from the spirit world, they actually have to learn the process. Just because they're there doesn't mean they necessarily understand it. And they have to be permitted to come through too. I mean, I've had sessions where I'll be working with someone and I'll notice as I'm working with them out of the corner of my eye that there's other people from spirit just sitting there observing the session who are present. And the people who are sitting there observing our session, they're not connected to me in any way, and they have absolutely no connection to the people I'm working with. But the reason why they're observing the session is because they're basically studying it and learning the process, because at some point, coming up pretty soon, one of their loved ones is going to be going to a session, they're going to be coming through a medium. And, you know, maybe on the other side of the planet, who knows? But they actually have to, like I say, rehearse it and actually learn the process. And, you know, you're going to find some people, just like here in the physical world, some people are just better communicators. You know, they're more extroverted.
Right. Now, how do you feel about attachments then? Or is it possible that we'll get attachments to us?
You know, I don't really buy into that myself. My own experiences is, I mean, obviously you can have someone who's into, let's say they're into excessive, you know, they're into pornography, or they're into, you know, different substances, you know, substance, alcohol or drugs and things like this, or just certain types of thinking that are not on a real high positive type of level. And you can certainly open yourself up to less than positive influences, both in both the physical plane level as well as potentially influences from the spirit world. You know, why not? Now, there's different levels in the spirit world, so like does attract like. So if you're hanging out in the gutter, you can attract the same type of mentality to you.
Right.
You know, that type of thing. And the extent that you allow yourself to be influenced, you can be influenced by that. Now, does that happen? I'm sure it does happen. On the other hand, we have free will. You know, we have our own connection with God, and it's, we don't have to let anything outside ourselves affect us or influence us.
Okay. And so what's your general opinion of things like the Ouija board?
A Ouija board is just a device. But the thing with spirit communication is spirit communication, it's not a game. It's really something that needs to be done with reverence. And really, it's the higher purpose of it. Obviously, it like demonstrates the continuity of life, the reality of life after death. That could obviously, I mean, I'm very, you know, being very psychic, I could make a prediction. I could say, everyone listening to this, you're all going to kick the bucket. You know, and I could say, Thursday, this week. But really, everyone's going to kick the bucket. Isn't this true? We're all going to pass over?
Yeah.
So we're all really psychic. And you have these different ways of communicating with the spirit world. So something like a Ouija board or any kind of communication, it's a really good thing, but it's not something which should be played as a game where someone's drunk at 3 a.m.
Right, yeah.
And so that's not good. But if you go back into the 19th century especially, they had a lot of devices like that, you know, where you move the pointer, you know, this type of thing. It's the same type of energy related to what we might find with like table tipping, you know, movements of the table. But it's very cumbersome. It's very slow as a process. But you could use a Ouija board or a similar type of device, and you could get some really high-level philosophical communications coming through. It really depends on the training. It's a device, the training and the energy that's created, you know, for people who are using it. You know, why are they doing it? You know, what is the reverence? You know, are they working with higher personalities, or are they just like a leaky faucet?
Yeah.
Opening up to anything, you know? And so there's nothing really wrong with that per se, but there is something wrong with people who don't really have a clue about what they're doing.
Yeah. Well, that's with anything. Like that. Yeah. But the Ouija board itself isn't like an evil thing.
No,
if you have one, everything bad's going to happen to you.
No,
right?
Not at all. But I mean, if you have someone playing around with that, you're going to open yourself up to something like that, and then you have trouble closing it because you don't know what you're doing. I mean, mediumship is really safe. It's really natural. And that's why, you know, I'm really into the training aspect, because I work with people and train them, you know, how to properly connect, how to recognize what's coming in from spirit. And there's a time to do it, and there's a time not to do it. So you can have someone, and they're like I say, like a leaky faucet. I mean, I know this one medium. He'll like this. I mean, he'll go into his dentist office, and every single person in the reception area, he'll start giving them readings. And then you've got the receptionist. She gets a reading. He goes in after 2 hours of waiting, and who gets it? You know, you have the dental hygienist gets it as well as the dentist. And they love it. He's there a couple hours. Now, you have to ask yourself, what type of quality, what type of reliability is there if you just open up anytime? You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's something which is carefully planned out and orchestrated by higher personalities. So if you're doing it with the right type of reverence and you're kind of controlling how you're working, what circumstances you're working, that type of thing, you're going to have the communications are going to be reliable, and it's going to be set up the right type of way. But if you're just like, you know, going up to people in Walmart or wherever and giving them a message, or, you know, you're driving through the McDonald's, seeing the fast food joint, and you stay there for an extra 10 minutes just to give the person, you know, the cashier there, give them, you know, a communication. And you know, that's just ridiculous. Yeah. But I mean, this is what it might look good on TV, but this isn't what it's about, you know?
Right, right.
That's probably like 101 like something you'd learn in the very first basic mediumistic development class would be not to do stuff like that, how to close it down, you know, not be open.
Yeah. Well, yeah, but, you know, I guess it's entertainment for TV, right?
You know, but it's like if I was a dentist, you'd use the dental exam. You know, like, oh, do you have a cavity? Just walk up to people and start looking in their mouth. Hey, I've got my pliers, you know. Let me pull it out, you know.
Well,
I probably could, but would you want me to?
Yeah, no. definitely not.
I've read a manual on it online. I know how to do it, you know? And that's the thing now. I call it microwavable mediumship. Yeah. So people will, I mean, literally instant, you know, they might not even study and they just go out and start doing it and everything. But it's not necessarily, you know, real what they're doing. It's not necessarily, the quality isn't necessarily there. Yeah. Even if they have good intention.
So now, do you find it hard if you get, to get, let's say you have a really, I don't know, I don't want to say negative, but not a happy sort of reading on someone. Is it really hard to pass that on to them?
You're talking about with the information that's coming through. Well,
yeah,
you know, it's whatever comes through. I mean, remember, this is being, it's for the benefit of the person who's the recipient, which may or may not be what they want to hear. That's one thing, but then we also have to consider that sometimes it's more for the person in spirit. Now, in terms of information coming through, they can be critical in spirit in a nice way. They can constructively give people input which might be completely opposite of what they want to hear. But generally speaking, I mean, they're not going to come through with something that would upset someone or something that would be negative.
Okay.
You know, your husband's going to die, you know, on Tuesday at 4:30, you know, that type of thing.
Get insurance.
You know, or you're going to meet a man with a gold tooth next week. I mean, that's kind of more of the fortune telling type stuff. But
but
I guess to answer your question, though, I mean, when I'm working, I can feel all the emotion. I'm very, you know, I'm empathic toward the person I'm working with, but I also have very good boundaries where I'm on a bit of a higher vibration, so I'm not affected by the person I'm working with and what their reaction might be, but then I'm very detached from it all too. So even though I might register the emotion coming in from spirit and even let myself be completely overwhelmed by it, I'm completely disciplined or in control of it and everything, and I just give the stuff out, so I don't allow myself to be on a personal level affected by what I would say, if that makes sense.
Yeah, you're just kind of passing on the information.
Yeah, which you know, I mean, if you have someone coming through and they're really feeling, let's say they're really feeling intense love, part of being a good medium is allowing yourself, that's expressed through you. You know, it's not like you're just some type of robot that's very cold, metallic, you know, I'm seeing this for you, you know, that type of thing. But then you kind of have to keep yourself out of it at the same time.
Right, right. Okay, so you want to pass it on, but you don't want to get too involved.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's not always what someone wants to hear. I mean, you get people that see, people just have so many misconceptions about this. You know, I want to hear from my mother. You know, if you don't bring my mother through.
Yeah.
You know, or, you know, I want to know if, you know, I'm having this affair with this guy at work. You know, when's he going to leave his wife for me? You know, I know he's my soulmate. The psychic, I say, Donna told me this. And,
yeah.
You know, that's not what the kind of information is going to come through. And then they don't get it and they don't necessarily like it. The other thing is I mean, with any kind of communications, it's, you know, the medium is raising their own vibration up and they're making a telepathic connection with personalities in the spirit world who feed them the information, and then they articulate it. Now, there has to be harmony there. Just like if you took your cell phone into the middle of nowhere, what kind of connection would you get?
Right.
I mean, it might be all garbled or choppy, or maybe you wouldn't get anything. And with mediumship, I mean, you can have someone come in for a session with a medium. I call them readings from hell. And it's, my gosh, like there's this wall there. It's, it can be very, 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 very hard to work with someone like that. Like the chemistry's not the way it could be.
Yeah.
Other people, I mean, some of the best people to work with actually are other mediums because they bring in the right types of energies and conditions that are there. So my experience has been that the more someone understands it, it's definitely beneficial because then they tend to be very enthusiastic about it and sympathetic toward it. And that type of mental, that type of mindset helps create the right type of atmosphere.
And so you were talking about misconceptions of mediums and stuff. So to start for someone, what would be the difference between a medium, let's say, or a psychic?
Well, a psychic, the difference is a psychic is someone who's using their intuitive ability and they're basically able to, with that intuitive ability, make a connection with the energy field of the person they're working with, or the energy of an object, or the energy, maybe the atmosphere of a physical location, and they're able to give information that way. And it's on more of a mundane type of level. When I say mundane, I don't mean inferior level. I just mean it's a denser, the source of the information is different. Now, with spirit communication, the medium's using that same intuitive ability, and they're raising their own vibration, and then they're connecting with personalities in the spirit world. And the psychic senses correspond to our five physical senses, so a medium is able to hear, they're able to feel or sense, they're able to see, smell and taste, or even just clear cognizance, clear knowing, you know, the information is able to come through. So the difference really just has to do with the source. And a lot of times, too, people who are psychics will use different devices. They might use cards or, you know, employ a system like numerology or astrology to do the session, which is just different.
Do you ever use any of those, or tarot cards or anything?
No, I never have. You know, I've never really been drawn to it. I find it would get in the way. I just go up to spirit and bring stuff through. It's very different. Now, there are some mediums who do mix that in, and my own feeling is just, in general, nothing wrong with those, because I do sometimes get students who are very analytically oriented, and sometimes I'll even suggest, hey, you know, get some cards and play around with the cards, because it helps loosen people up. It gives their mind structure to work with, at least initially, you know, in terms of learning this. You know, you find a lot of people that they learn some of these psychic arts. It's like a stepping stone to mediumship. But the problem is with those things, at least for the way I present myself, is I don't really want people to think that I'm a fortune teller. I don't work at psychic fairs, things of that type of sort. It's right. Not superficial. It's not like a carnival. It's not supposed to be on that type of level.
Now, so do you think that those people are kind of not as real, like people doing psychic fairs or...
Yeah, people who do... Well, they're really good people. I mean, I suppose it just depends on the person, doesn't it? I mean, those are all really valid, really good ways of helping people. It's just that a psychic fair is on a very... it's like a carnival. It can be a very superficial type of... the way things are presented. And I mean, if you get into, for example, astrology or even working with cards, both of those approaches can be highly spiritual, depending how you're doing it, and really don't have to be done like a cheap fortune-telling type of approach. But even so, it's not really mediumship. You know, it's something different. Not saying that, you know, the spirit people wouldn't be able to work through someone like that, because they do.
Yeah.
But with mediumship, it's different. At least the way I would present it would be different.
Well, I would think like calling like the member of the old 1-800 psychic, you know, Madame Cleo and stuff.
Yeah, stuff like that. You know, the 1-900 psycho hotlines. You know.
Yeah, like I think that sort of brings the whole medium psychic sort of thing down.
Yeah, oh yeah, it does. Well, that's what it's not about at all. And people just don't know any better. I mean, I've noticed that. I mean, because I work all different types of venues worldwide, you know, people's organizations will have me come, you know, do presentations. And I mean, so I've certainly worked in places which maybe tends to present predominantly stuff more on a psychic type of level. Consequently, you know, you'll have clients coming for a session and that's what they're used to. You know, it's maybe very different than someone who's more familiar with mediumship in terms of how it works and what they want. So I think that all of that definitely has its place and it's related, but it's just a bit different, you know, in terms of the approach.
Yeah, yeah.
And it can be presented in a very cheap type of, you know, low-grade way too, you know.
Well,
I mean, they have like psychic sex lines and everything.
Yeah.
The psychic reading, God knows what else you get.
Yeah, you know, two for one here.
Exactly.
So, and how do you feel about, have you ever had any experience or dealing with like remote viewing or people that have astral traveling and stuff?
Yeah. All of that stuff is awesome. You know, I used to do quite a bit of that. I teach programs with that as well. Now, first of all, remote viewing used to be called traveling clairvoyance. Which it's different than out-of-body travel or astral travel. in the sense the astral travel or out of body travel, you're actually literally going out of your your physical body and your subtle body and traveling to different places. And that can be done consciously or more on an unconscious type of level, which a lot of people do while in their sleep state. But remote viewing basically is, you know, you're able to project your awareness and be able to see things at a distance. And that's quite amazing.
Yeah. Do you believe in that sort of thing, remote
viewing? Oh, well, I teach that type of thing. I'm totally into that type of thing. I mean, if you get into remote viewing, clairvoyance, I mean, that's a type of mediumship as well. Spirit will work with you that way.
So if someone's having that experience, someone that's going to sleep at night, and they feel like maybe not remote viewing, maybe it's more about traveling, but they're having these things happen to them at night. Is that something they should be scared of, or something?
Well, it's, you know, when something happens like that to someone, it can be really startling. I mean, I can understand someone could really be frightened by that, couldn't they?
Yeah.
So, but it's good to learn about it. I mean, it can be very dramatic, too. I mean, see, most times when it does happen is it'll happen on an unconscious level. It's like sleepwalking.
Right.
And someone will have a very vivid dream where they're kind of half asleep and half awake. And maybe they'll be in another location or flying or floating, that type of thing. And that's not too scary for people in most cases. But let's say someone has a conscious out-of-body experience and they've never had that happen. And what are they going to think? They're going to think, my God, I'm not in my body anymore. I must have died.
Yeah.
No, and how do I get back in? That's probably going to be the first thought, because we're so conditioned by our being within these dense physical bodies. You know, we function through these five limited physical senses, and we experience our physical reality through them. And so it's really hard, even though we are also embodied on these subtle levels as well that interpenetrate our physical bodies. We're still focusing in on the physical. So when someone, especially if they just, it's out of their mindset to even be open to something like that happening, when it does take place, it can really, really kind of shock them with the experience.
Yeah.
Of course, we have so many examples of people who have near-death experiences, and, you know, initially maybe they're startled, but they actually even journey into the spirit world. They might even connect with, you know, loved ones or teachers in spirit, and it tends to be a really positive experience.
So do these happen for a reason? So when I get...
Yeah, they do. They definitely happen for a reason.
So I get messages and things from people all the time.
Uh-huh.
And quite often, as of late for some reason, I've had a lot of people that talk about, you know, in their sleep going to places and being someone different than they are and then waking up and going through these experiences a lot. So is that sort of something triggering in them?
Yeah, well, what my experience has been, what I've seen is our teachers in spirit will definitely, I think, cause those types of experiences to take place, and it's to get people more in touch with themselves. I mean, for example, let's say someone does go out of their body, whether it's a near-death experience or just happens, there's a higher reason for that, and it's going to really change that person's complete outlook in life for the better.
Yeah, hopefully.
So that, I mean, some cases too, let's say someone is going to work. I mean, I remember when I started really developing my mediumship, you know, really getting, I mean, I've always been open to some extent, but really getting into it more, I would have a lot of out-of-body experiences. It was pretty common. Now, right now, if I go out, I mean, I'm in such a deep unconscious state, I'm not necessarily aware of it, you know, but if you go back, whatever, 30-something years ago or whenever, you know, it would have been probably necessary for my development.
Okay, so it's probably a step that they're going through.
Yeah, my experience is that people do it for a while, and then it serves its purpose, and then it's not necessarily going to be there predominantly the way it would have been. Maybe there's exceptions to that, but just in general. I think, too, the more someone, I mean, for example, what I tell people a lot of times, you know, read a lot of books about it, and if they maybe experiment with different methods, see what works, because, you know, different methods for out-of-body travel are going to work differently for different people. But if you're thinking about it a lot, what's happening? Your unconscious mind is going to be completely programmed for that type of experience, and you'll probably start to have it happen. And one of the things that does happen on an unconscious level, so we have like lucid dreaming or, you know, keeping like dream journals, things of this sort.
Right.
That trains the mind, and more of your, you can become more consciously aware of it. And as that happens, that can just only increase as you do it more. You know, in terms of, you know, thinking, okay, I want to travel, let's say visit my cousin in Oklahoma, you know, and you start doing it, you know, and then he even notices that you're there watching him, you know, while he's studying in his office or something. So you can really experiment with this, and you can set it up with other people too. You know, their dog notices you when you're in the living room.
Wow.
You know, there are a lot of experiments you can do where, you know, I mean, actually, with remote viewing, you could do similar things, you know, to actually try to read things or, you know, get certain targets, you know, and project to the target. But my experience with some of those things is it works better where there's actually like an emotional and spiritual connection where you're actually doing it with a person as opposed to some type of material object or location.
Yeah. And you mentioned the near-death experiences. So do you have an opinion on that sort of thing? Is that kind
of that's to awaken people. You know, we're not our bodies, are we? We're spirit, soul, we're eternal. You know, the physical body, I mean, every single molecule, every single cell, on average about 7 years, everything's changed, and you have a new body. So someday you'll have a body of an elderly man, but that's not the same body you would have had when you were a teenager. But the consciousness, the personality, stays the same, you see? Yeah. So there's a higher purpose to life, and really, because we can think about why we're here, we can actually develop some type of relationship with God, we can actually work on ourselves, we can improve ourselves as people and develop our character. And if we don't do those things while we're here, those are issues which we're going to have to work on once we go to the spirit world. You know, if you needed 50 years of psychotherapy and you don't get it, you're going to definitely...
So we're taking all this with us.
Yeah, you take all of it. On a subtle level, all your baggage, all the good qualities go with you, but all the subtle baggage goes there too.
So someone that's done something really treacherous, you know, I hate to bring up a name, but let's say Hitler. Someone that's done something that's been quite devastating to a lot of people, let's say. Now, they're going to take that with them, and... Do they have to go through something, do you think, after that then? Or?
Well, there's if you get into the Vedic scriptures,
right.
Vedas, you know, or Buddhist scripture, they talk about different hellish planets or hellish regions. And in spiritualism, we understand that there's like lower astral levels, which are very, very dense and thick. So like attracts like. Jesus said, "In my Father's house are many mansions." And he's not talking about housing developments either, is he?
No.
You know, he's talking about these different levels of spirit. So you have someone who's of a real low level, they go to a very low level, and you can't escape the consequences of your action. Now, there's God's all-loving, and the doorway is never closed. It's never slammed shut. I mean, there's always an opportunity for growth, even if you're Adolf Hitler. But if you've inflicted a lot of suffering on other humans, you know, animals, I mean, any other sentient beings, there's a reaction for it. And, you know, we see this. If we are really a total jerk to someone else, it's going to, what goes around comes around. You know, someone will be a jerk to us. If you go punch someone in the face, you're going to get punched in the face at some point.
Right.
You know, it's natural law. So there's definitely people who have done, I mean, you know, we're all certainly... have done things where we've fallen short, you know, of what we could be doing. That's part of the process of learning. But we have to accept responsibility for what we've done. And,
right.
And certainly there's consequences. It's not just like we're going to go blend in some white light and everything's okay. It's not how it works.
Yeah. Yeah, there's got to be something. That's sort of what I mean, you know, karma in a sense.
Well, I remember one of my teachers in mediumship, and this is going back, she used to sit in this one development group, I think it was on Wednesday nights, you know, at the church that she was, the spiritualist church that she was part of. And anyway, she had to have surgery. So anyway, it was happened to be scheduled on the same night that she would normally go to her development group. And so everyone at the church knew that she was having the surgery, and obviously they were going to pray for her. So anyway, she was having the operation, and they put her out, and she actually found herself consciously looking down at her physical body from up toward the ceiling. And so she could see all the nurses, doctors, and all of this, you know, working on her physical body. But she was also simultaneously aware of the group at the church. And she actually saw, because they were saying prayers, she saw the energy from the absent healing or distant healing that they were doing going from the circle and going into her physical body that was below her. Now, during that same extraordinary experience, she found herself moving into the world of spirit, and she saw this gentleman sitting there. And I'm sure everyone who's listening to this has seen the statue by Rodin of the thinker. And this guy was like that, in that position, with his fist up to his chin. And he was looking into what looked to be like some type of television or computer monitor. Now, this is before computers would have been big. This is going back, you know, at least 50 years or more when this took place. And he wasn't saying anything. He was just looking into the screen. And what she was aware of is that he was basically having to literally look at his life, you know, because he had passed over, and literally go over every single little bit of his life and even go back and re-examine a couple times, you know, the areas that he hadn't done as well. And it wasn't like there was some type of external power or personality that was judging him. He was having to actually kind of come to terms within himself for whatever he had done or not done. So that out-of-body experience was really very profound for her, you know, just in terms of having that happen. Obviously, that was set up by her guides, you know, in terms of making that happen with what took place.
So do we choose our spirit guides, or do they choose us?
Well, they choose us, but then again, a lot of it has to do with what you're doing in terms of working on yourself. I mean, if you're really putting a lot of energy into your spirituality, you're going to attract people who are going to want to work with you that way. I mean, let's face it. I mean, if you were a, let's say you taught some type of sport, you know, you really want to teach people who are basketball players, and you found some kid who was really into wanting to develop their basketball skills, you'd put all your energy into that person, wouldn't you?
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, why waste your time with someone who, not that you wouldn't want to help someone else, but, you know, someone who's not really interested in it.
Right.
You know, so it's the same thing with the spirit world. And I mean, and the other thing is, I mean, you can have someone, they're an atheist, or they're just someone who doesn't believe in us. They think it's a bunch of bunk. There's going to be people in the spirit world who are still going to try to influence that person, even some unethical, sleazy politician. I'm sure Adolf Hitler had a lot of people who were higher level who tried to get through to the guy, but he just wasn't listening.
Right.
You know, we have free will. I mean, so the spirit world can tell us things, they can suggest, they can try to kind of help us along the path, but we can do whatever we want. We can go off, we can jump off the path.
Yeah. And so do you think there's reincarnation then? Do we come back?
Well, we change our body every 7 years, and the soul is eternal. So let's say you're here for 70 years, you're here 100 years, maybe you're only here, maybe you're not even born, you know, you pass over before you're born, which happens. I mean, the soul is eternal. It's there from before conception. But you can't have growth of the body without the presence of consciousness or spirit. So in terms of coming back, reincarnation is a reality. But what's probably most important isn't so much focusing on our past lives, it's more focusing on the present in terms of our own growth. Now, I mentioned to you, I have a new book that's out. It's called Mediumship Mastery. Mediumship Mastery, The Mechanics of Receiving Spirit Communications, The Ultimate Guide. It's just come out in April, and it's actually a book that's totally focused on mediumship development. And one of the chapters is past life readings. And that talks about, you know, people, I've had clients over the years, you know, coming who have information coming through from spirit, you know, relating to their past lives. And it's always something which is very relevant to what's taking place within their own life in terms of how things are affecting them.
Wow.
But you'd like my new book if you're interested in mediumship.
Oh, yeah, for sure. It looks very good.
Yeah, well, it's available only on Amazon, you know, worldwide.
Well, that's actually the perfect way.
No, it's great. It's gotten really good reviews, you know, from other mediums, just in general. People like it, so hopefully it will keep that way. It's very informative, and good for all aspects of mediumship development and psychic awareness.
And you're giving now you give classes and you give tutoring and stuff. So
I do. Well, I do a lot of things. I mean, first of all, I'm touring. Like I said, New Zealand only has 4.2 million people, so it's kind of small here. But I do most of my work outside of New Zealand, so I'm probably on the road a good 4 months at least, or more in some cases each year. So I teach, you know, one-off types of workshops on mediumship, all aspects of mediumship, psychic awareness, and healing. But I also have my mediumship mastery training program, and those are more 2 or 3 day intensives, sometimes a week long intensives, focusing with mediumship. And that's worldwide at different locations. I have programs in the States, which take place in New England, and we have that a couple times a year, you know, which the information is on my website, stevehermannmedium.com.
Okay, there you go. I was just going to ask.
Yeah.
Yeah, I see you're psychic.
Must be. Either that or I'm psychotic, you know?
Yeah. Well, there's always that.
Well, there's a fine line between mental illness and mediumship, and I mean that in a nice way. But, you know, you have people that are very open to the spirit world, and they need to be heavily medicated.
Yeah. Well, too much pressure, too much stress.
Yeah, you know, they're hearing all the voices, you know.
Yeah.
And they don't want to listen to those voices either, but that's another whole story. Then you have people who are medicated who really shouldn't be medicated. They just need to go to a development class, and that's why I'm into the education, because I want to help people that way.
Yeah.
The more people that can actually open up with it and get in touch with themselves, get in touch with God, it doesn't matter what your religion is or what someone's philosophical outlook is, and it's all about service. And the higher personalities, they actually grow through the service they do through us.
And so do you think now in the world in general right now, do you think we're on a good path or maybe not?
Well, the material world, it's really a beautiful place, but then it's also a really ugly place too. I mean that in a nice way. You know, you have potential for great good. You know, you could have a disaster. So much goodness will come out of people's hearts because of that disaster. But at the same time, it's this material world, it's like a motel. You know, you go to a motel, you might stay 2 or 3 days because you're visiting some location or you're traveling through. But it's not your whole life. That's not really your real home, is it?
Yeah.
So this material world we're in, we may live here, you know, we come here, but it's not really our real home. And we got very attached to it. And it's a cause of suffering. You know, no matter what we do, there's always going to be natural disasters. There's always going to be potentially disease of the body. There's going to be conflict, you know, potentially. So there's a lot of suffering here. And that suffering can actually help us to, you know, grow in awareness and improve ourselves in terms of our relationship as spirit. But it's definitely, I think the material world's always going to, it's always going to be that way. The big thing is it's working on ourselves, and you can't really change other people. You can only change yourself, but in doing so, you can influence other people and help them to grow as well. But people are in different places, so there's definitely people in the physical world who aren't necessarily that evolved.
Oh, yeah.
And that can't be forced, you know? You can't, you can expose them, you know? Someone like Jesus comes, and what happened to him, you know?
Yeah.
People don't necessarily want to hear something that's on a higher level, even if it's just real basic information. Other people will be really, really, really open to it and want to grow. So one of the things which is really good right now is we do have the internet, you know, we have all these media communications, and so you can bring really high-level awareness to people worldwide, globally, in a way that you couldn't have, even going back 10 or 20 years ago, which I think is wonderful.
Yeah, I think it's really good. Of course, with that comes a lot of the, you know, bad stuff as well.
Yeah, well, you can do that. It works both ways.
Oh, yeah. So
it's like what you're doing with your radio show. I think it's totally awesome. It's so good because, you know, you don't know who's going to listen to it and how it will change their life just by listening to it.
Oh yeah, exactly. You know, if you have 100 or you have 1,000, you just never know.
It's all education. I mean, that's what I'm in. I'm really into the teaching. You know, I have my, you know, my new book, but then just in general, you know, when I can teach someone, I love. I mean, I do a lot of private sessions or larger group types of things, which are great. But when someone actually goes inside themselves, they discover their own gifts, what's going to happen? They're going to be better in terms of where they're at within their own life in handling things, the challenges, because the challenges that we're dealing with, they're not really going to be taken away. It's how we respond to those things where we make the progress. But then the other thing is if someone starts to open up with their mediumship, what are they going to do with it? They're going to be able to help other people. And we are our brother's keepers. You know, the more we actually extend ourselves out, we can really do so much. Even though it's very hellish in this material world, we can do so much to bring some type of higher light into it. Just like Mother Teresa, who's Roman Catholic, said, you know, we want to just be like small hands, you know, or instruments for God to work through. Same as the prayer of St. Francis. You know, the whole motivation behind that is allowing yourself to be used as an instrument.
Well, that's certainly been a great conversation and lots to think about.
Yeah, we could go on with this for like 5 years. And yeah. I like your energy a lot.
Thank you. Yours is quite good, too.
Oh, well, thank you. Yeah, well, it's really great. But, you know, like I said, if anyone's interested, you know, I'm stevehermannmedium.com is my website. And I do, you know, mentoring. And I have, obviously, I do, you know, private sessions and all that. But I do have the training programs and my new book, Mediumship Mastery, that's available on Amazon. And definitely check it out. I mean, it's appropriate for people who are very experienced as well as people who are novices. Right. It's got 84 easy to follow exercises in it, which are for all different levels, and it's quite awesome as a book. Took me quite a few years to put it together.
Fantastic.
Show is over for now.
Was it as good for you as it was for me?
Well, good night.
This has been a production of the Z-Talk Radio Network.
I'll be back.